Climate change is making extreme weather events like wildfires, floods, and hurricanes more frequent and more severe. And beyond the direct effects, there can be deadly secondary effects. Ali Rogin explores one that became especially evident after some of this season's worst storms.
It's a gas with no odor, no taste, and no color. But if not detected, it can be deadly. Carbon monoxide, or CO, is released after burning fuels like those used to run a power generator. Scientists now say that CO poisonings are on the rise amid widespread power outages following extreme weather events. A recent report in ProPublica details the devastating impact this summer's Hurricane Beryl had on increasing the number of carbon monoxide poisonings in Texas. ProPublica's Lexi Churchill wrote the story. Lexi, thank you so much for being here. What is the link between the use of generators and the risk of carbon monoxide poisoning?
Yeah, thanks so much for having me. So this link is something that the Consumer Product Safety Commission has actually been studying for decades. So we know a lot about what we know now from them. In the time that they've been studying this connection, they found that portable generators actually lead to about 70 deaths every year, which makes portable generators one of the most dangerous devices that consumers can buy on the market today. In fact, the commission has found that no other device has killed as many people from carbon monoxide poisoning as portable generators have. And the reason why they're so dangerous is because these sometimes very small devices, just one of them can emit as much carbon monoxide gas as hundreds of cars can combined. So many of them also do not have a sort of automated switch to turn off once those levels become dangerous.
So why are we seeing this increase in poisoning if we've known about the risks for many decades?
So we know from climate scientists that these extreme weather events are becoming more frequent, leading to widespread power outages that can last weeks, affecting millions of people and leave folks in the summer in the heat, trying to stave off of heat deaths, in the winter, trying to stave off hypothermia deaths as well. So we're seeing the opportunity for folks to use these portable generators increase. And we also see that after these extreme weather events, the purchase of portable generators continue to spike, which only furthers this cycle.
And your story alludes to some people who put their portable generators very close to their house. Why are people doing that? And are the risks of doing that well spelled out for folks?
So this family has actually been using a portable generator for years. They live close to Houston, so they've lived through several hurricanes, the winter storm in 2021 that caused huge widespread outages, and they're used to using this generator safely. They haven't had any issues before. So this is a family that knows the risks, knows they need to keep a generator 20 feet from their home, and just in this one instance made the mistake of moving it slightly closer. And they put it under their porch in anticipation of rain from the hurricane to keep the generator safe so their power could continue to run. Unfortunately, that led to all three family members being hospitalized and having to be treated by the most extreme level, considering that doctors told them they were minutes away from dying. So we see instances like this of families who do know the risk that maybe make a simple mistake, but we also see a lot of families that don't understand the dangers of these portable generators or other devices like running a car in your enclosed garage and other instances like that that can also emit dangerous levels of carbon monoxide.
The families you profile in your story were in Texas, which has relatively lax requirements when it comes to carbon monoxide poisonings. Is there a correlation between the increase in poisonings and states that do not have strong detector regulations?
So I would make one slight point there. When we first started reporting on this in 2021, after the winter storm Uri I mentioned before, at that point, Texas did not have any statewide requirement, which was one of only a handful of states at the time that didn't have any protections. Since winter storm Uri, they've passed an updated code that now requires CO detectors in some new buildings and renovated buildings as well, which of course is only a fraction of buildings in the state and leaves millions and millions of homes unprotected. So this isn't something I've seen has been directly studied, but certainly public health officials tell us that carbon monoxide detectors are the only surefire way to prevent these poisonings. As you mentioned at the beginning, you cannot smell this gas, you cannot see it, there is no way to sense it other than whether a carbon monoxide detector tells you the levels are growing to be more dangerous. So certainly advocates tell us that the common sense solution is to pass further requirements to require these in every home. The correlation hasn't totally been studied, but that's what public health experts tell us.
What do policymakers say who are arguing against regulating and requiring carbon monoxide detectors? These are cheap things that could save your life.
So it's funny because you don't really see a lot of arguments against these requirements, but you don't really see anyone carrying this issue so that it has become law. It's not something that's really captured state lawmakers' attention as far as we can tell. In the aftermath of Winter Storm Uri, instead, Texas state lawmakers have focused on the underlying issue, which of course is the grid, the power grid, and making sure that that continues running well. So that there aren't these major power outages. But we haven't seen one lawmaker, at least in public, champion this issue of carbon monoxide poisoning and therefore put forth solutions for carbon monoxide detectors. So we haven't seen many lawmakers come out against this solution necessarily, but we haven't seen any that have brought it forward either.
Lexi Churchill with ProPublica, thank you so much.
Thank you.